you start to see kind of who we're really targeting. It's the backbone of our workforce that is increasingly getting priced out. So I don't know. I live in Oakland, and I can tell you that when I come in the morning, we've got folks that are coming in from Tracy, from Stockton, that have started their commutes at 3 and 4 in the morning, just so they can get to a job that can pay the bills. But unfortunately, they can't. I mean, the wages that they're making don't translate into enough house for them. And so they're moving and coming from further and further afield.
I can't quite see, but tell me what the 15% of AMR is.
So it's actually not on there. So we've got it. So we're showing. And part of the reason that we've adapted this from a broader presentation, but at 20% of AMI, it's right around $14,000 a year. So 15% of AMI is going to be just below that. It's really, again, these are folks that are transitioning from homelessness, and the goal is to make sure that we're providing stable housing that makes sense for them as they re-enter the workforce and contribute. Yes, sir.
I'm not 13% of AMI. I know a lot of, personally, but I know a lot of homeless people down here right now have zero income. Mm-hmm. And those who get GA make $350 a month. Mm-hmm. Are you going to have any programs in place working with your partner, TNDC, to try to get some subsidized housing for the people who don't make cut-off?
Yeah, so that's actually a great question. So our the units that we're designing for the formerly homeless are going to be subsidized using what's called a local operating subsidy program that's administered through the new Department of Homelessness and Supportive Housing. And so we're going to be providing, TNDC rather, is going to be providing wraparound support services for those residents, in addition to the subsidies that are required to help them true up and make their rent.
Cool. So yeah, you kind of identified our point of most interest around here. But what will be the size of those units? The smaller.
So the smallest units, I believe, are sourced. So actually, so the lost subsidies are going to be applied. So we're going to be applying those across the portfolio. So it's not just for. So we'll have studios, one bedrooms, two bedrooms, and three bedrooms that'll be available to the full spectrum of need for the formerly homeless. And so our smallest unit, our studios are going to be just shy of 400 square feet, and our three bedrooms are right around 1,250 square feet in size.
So for people that live here and live next door, 400 square feet is huge.
It's huge.
Yeah.
It's almost a waste.
Yeah.
However, two people have worked pretty nicely.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And our one bedrooms are going to be right around over 500 square feet as well.
Before I get to the one bedrooms. But however.
Yes, sir.
We have an ongoing problem in this neighborhood because it's people that are in that 13, 14, 12% of AMI, mm-hmm. kind of topping out at 15, mm-hmm. and they get stuck in these units here, which are very small. Mm-hmm. These ones actually are not so bad. Susan's actually got a kind of a nice one, but they get stuck in small units, and it's the American dream would be, after some point in time, these are hotels, mm-hmm. that we live in. Mm-hmm. American dream would be to transition into a full unit like, mm-hmm. one of those. Do you think maybe somewhere you're thinking about it, you could reserve maybe one unit for formerly living in hotels?
I'll go you one further. What I'd like to do is I'd like to take that suggestion.
We're good people.
Absolutely.
We're talking about people who have lived in for a decade or more.
Yeah.
Who have proven that they're good residents.
Understood. And I think part of the longer term services programming and housing programming is going to require that we take a look holistically at how we create those opportunities. And so right now is a really good time, frankly, because the Mayor's Office of Housing and Community Development Department of Housing and or of Homelessness and Supportive Housing and the partners, the nonprofit partners and for-profit partners that are out executing these programs are in the middle of helping to shape what that environment looks like. There are new draft guidelines that have been issued for
So
I think that's actually, again, it's an opportune time to bring that suggestion up, and I'm happy to relay that to you, to the Director of Supportive Housing and Services at TNDC, as well as to staff at the city.
I wanted to say a lot of the problem with the small areas is that so many people are also paying for storage somewhere else. Mm-hmm. And I got an education in the whole storage thing. And, you know, it's almost, it's a place for my stuff. Mm-hmm.
It's almost a tax.
Yes, and I knew someone that would probably be able to afford a place to live almost if she didn't have a storage unit that they kept raising the price on. Mm-hmm. And she couldn't sleep there. It was like, this is another little tax on the poor. Mm-hmm. It's not, and you can't say, well, you shouldn't have all that stuff, because, if she didn't have some stuff, she wouldn't, when she finally got a place, she needs to furnish it, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And be able to put something in there.
Mm-hmm. So that's an issue that we grapple with, Part of our challenge is that we do have a fairly tight set of guidelines that the state mandates that we have to design to, mm-hmm. and that trickles down to the design guidelines here within the city, and so that's a factor that a lot of folks don't really think about. I think a little bit, it's a concern, and it's a question that mm-hmm. that I think we need to bring up as well. So I'm happy to take that up to our team. Yes, ma'am.
I have a couple of Susan said. My unit, I don't know, very hard to speak. I found people have a house before and have job, and I have many things. They have many things. What I'm going to do for keep my housing now? Let's store it. It's a lot of money for I pay store it now. Mm-hmm. More than I pay here. Mm-hmm. That's a trouble I try to my friend here, she stay here a long time to see Mavis. Mm-hmm. She's nice heart and volunteer, help here every week, help coffee, everything. She said we didn't have a good choice to nice place to live in now, just here. That's I don't know how to say it. Manager like me too, sometimes I'm very sick and go, but I try to volunteer. I'm sick a lot. But it's really hard. She said my friend who volunteer every week. She was like three days a week, a volunteer. She said we cannot get the better pace.
Well, hopefully, we're building 143 units here. So Meta in particular, within the mission where we're primarily serving, we've got just shy right now of 500 new units that we're building, and those are at a variety of different unit sizes. But they're all affordable, and we're indexing those to roughly 50% of area median income. But we hope to have a broader spectrum of housing opportunities that'll be available for folks to apply for, and so applications for each of the projects, including this, will typically open about 6 months prior to construction. To completion of construction rather. And so we'll continue. We're happy to continue to come by, provide updates on the project as well as the leasing opportunities that do come up, and will come up as we go through our project life cycle.
I'd like to thank you guys a lot.
Marcus, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I can
meet people.
I'll break that up. Thank you so much. And so I'll send you over a copy of our geotech report as well as a copy of this deck.
Yeah, I didn't think of our
Absolutely.
Our next presenter, we can suddenly turn the lights back on. The lights are on the side walls over by the doors. Good. And we have a set over here too. This door.
Thank you. Do we get going with this?
So we'll do 999 Folsom next.
Hello, I'm Luis Quadra with Bird Davis Public Affairs. I'm here with Gary Gee, the architect here, to present the 999 Folsom Street project. I'm the community relations representative for the project. The project is located on the intersection of Simpson Folsom to the Gene Friend Rec Center. The building is 82 feet, 8 stories. We're proposing a total of 95 rental units, 38 of which will be 2-bedroom, 37 will be 1-bedroom, and 20 will be studios. The retail spaces on Folsom, 6th and Shipley Street total approximately 1,500 square feet. We're proposing 35 car and 95 bike parking spaces. The requirement for affordable housing is 13.5% on site, and we're proposing 16.5, which is approximately 13. We are still in discussions with the community. We work very closely with Supervisor Kim's office, with the Solo Filipinas, which represents 19 local organizations, as well as United Players, to develop a package of community benefits. We're finalizing that, but in essence, it will involve financial commitment to these organizations, as well as some designation of retail space for a community organization. We are hoping for a joint Recreation and Planning Commission hearing sometime in September. Those are kind of just the facts and figures of the project, and with that, I'm going to turn it over to Gary and let him do a presentation, and then open it up to questions.
I'll talk from the pack that I just circulated to you. On the rendering, what you see in front of you is a proposed building. It's 8 stories high with 95 units. The front of the building here is 6th Street, and on your left-hand side is the frontage on Folsom Street. Right now, on the existing site, it's a parking garage with a small concession that does auto detailing. If you turn to the second page, you see the site plan. On the bottom is 6th Street. On your left-hand side is Folsom, and on the right-hand side is the Alley Shipley.
Could you kind of turn a little bit towards the camera a minute? Yeah.
Right.
Okay, a little back now. Okay.
Actually, this might be easier to read on the camera.
Yeah, okay.
So on the third page, which you see there, again, it's a similar plan, but it shows the ground floor. One of the things that we were working with the planning department was the exposure of commercial store frontage along all the street frontages, including Shipley. You'll see that in the beige color, that's all the commercial space, which is around 5,800 square feet. The other item you see in the light gray is the parking area, and the other sort of utility organizations I need for the building. The lobby is on Folsom Street, which you see in yellow is your circulation. Typical floor plan is on the podium level, where you have a U-shaped building. Right now, as Louis said, we have 20 studio units, 27 one-bedrooms, and 38 two-bedroom units. Okay, great. Our gross residential area right now is around 82,000 square feet. The total area of the building is around 92,000 square feet for our calculations. And as you can see, we have a sort of a nice, an open space area in the on the property line, which is on the east side. We also have a total of around 7,600 square feet of open space in the building. It includes on the second floor and on the roof, which is in, the next drawing you see. We have a roof deck that shows a generous roof deck along with solar panels on the roof. The building right now is 82 feet high. It's within an 85-foot height height limit. The building itself, as you can see from the front rendering, the first six stories are pretty much following the property line, and the top two floors are set back. This is something to reduce the mass and its presence from the street. So right now we're in the process of sort of meeting with the planning department to finalize some of the design elements for the building. I'll be happy to answer any other questions you may have.
Did you say this is commercial rental? I'm not commercial rental, but private party.
If the plan is for them to be rental apartments.
Rental apartments, okay. And that would be that would not be affordable housing, right?
16.5% of the units, which is approximately 13, will be on-site affordable.
Okay, on-site affordable. Thank you.
This question about the soil?
Yep.
Oh, okay.
I noticed that according to this, most of the soils you're on are either dense or coarsely dense or medium dense. Until you start getting down roughly about 15, 20 feet, then you get into the loose soils.
Mm-hmm.
I love native feet.
Well, of course, on 6th Street's a name. It's sort of the natural drainage of all of the tenderloin
But I do know that I didn't find anywhere it talks about there's actually sand dune down there, just sort of loose, coarse sands. So I'm wondering how much brick do you have underneath you?
Does it talk about any debris, layer of debris? Usually in these areas, south of Market, there was a layer of debris from the earthquake that just kind of threw things in and they filled it in. And plus the streets were like dikes and then everything else.
But this is what worries me in this part of town, because you're heavy in liquefaction. There's an amazing amount of stuff you don't want under your building under it. And so like I asked the guy here for 1990 Folsom, are you going to put any pilings in to support your building for this flat mat foundation?
It's driven piles in the report. They're going probably, if I recall, maybe about 95 feet into bedrock. That's what the recommendation is. It varies because the cross strata of the site, some area may be 105, some may 95, but they said that you're looking at piles probably deeper than the height of the building. The building's 80 feet.
And a groundwater rise, and I'll say the water rise, which is inevitable. Worried about the groundwater rise getting higher than your foundation level of your building, where it could compromise your foundation?
So I think what we have to do there is set up our soil engineer, our structural engineer, to decide if we're going to do a dewatering plan, do you locate sump pumps? Different areas of the building and pump any water that comes close to the bottom of the mat, because there'll be a mat at the bottom. We don't have a basement, all right? We're just slab on grade type of construction.
Yes, the area is not good for basement.
Right, no, not the 6th Street, not 6th Street, yeah. And so those are the discussions we'll have with our structural engineer and our soil engineer, how to dewater the site through the life of the building.
Because this is how largely people focus on now. You know, a lot of people, when they talk about issues, they don't look at 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, or the life of the building, even 100 years, and what will be going on underground from then. So this is what I'm looking into.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate that.
And I'm waiting on your EIR. Okay.
You're waiting on our EIR?
Okay.
We'll make sure you get it.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Show me where, but where's the Gene Frank in relation to the...
It's Kitty Corner.
Kitty Corner.
It's Kitty Corner.
I got it. Okay. We're going to rely on Jane Kim's office to try to get that inclusionary.
That's
BMR.
We're going to have discussions. We're going to have
people around here, we look at kind of in favor of being a little higher. Right, you get it there.
good feedback.
Thank you.
Thank you.